This week at the Internet Cafe, Therapy Online. This is supportgroup.com, a meta site for finding the right kind of cyber friends to help you with a problem. Don Hadlock is a psychotherapist, and you can get help from him online at his Process Therapy Institute. For people with AIDS or HIV, there is online counseling at several sites that can help you or a loved one cope with the disease. For some people, the net itself is the problem. If you're worried about internet addiction, psychologist Dr. Nancy Wesson may be able to help. And if you just want to work through your problem on your own, try logging on to the company therapist. Therapy Online, this week at the Internet Cafe. Net Cafe is brought to you by the Oracle Small Business Suite, one completely integrated application that helps make it easier to run your business, including accounting, sales and service, your web presence, and more. Additional funding is provided by PC2PC, the online migration service from PC First, moving files, applications, and preferences from your old computer to your new one. Well, we're talking about therapy on the web, group therapy, individual therapy, counseling. Do you think there's any value in that? Could you find value in going online and just talking to a bunch of people and solving a problem?
Well, I think there's benefit in being able to share experiences.
And I think peer-to-peer, not with a therapist necessarily.
Yeah, the idea of counseling on the internet kind of makes me feel a little uncomfortable. I'm not sure that would be something I'd want to do.
Andrew, what do you think?
I think Dr. Freud might be a little bit intrigued by all this fixation on
Dr.
the computer.
Freud.
Yeah, I don't know what he would make of it. But I think for some things it may be good. I think the real group therapy, oftentimes you need real people in a real...
Doesn't work in a chat room.
You need the support, you need the human interaction
the
to really...
Too.
Yeah, to come through.
Well, the honesty, I think, is the issue. Because it's the same old story on the web. You don't know if people are lying and whether they're telling the truth or whether they're even who they say they are.
Right.
So I guess caution is in order, but we're going to find out tonight.
So, Annette, you've got a website. It's called supportgroup.com. How did you get started doing this?
We were doing some local web design for businesses in our community, and we decided to put up a small bulletin board to list community events. And we had a gentleman who runs a local Graves' disease support group, and he posted an upcoming meeting, and within about a month, we had about 10 different messages from across the internet, people looking for more information on Graves' disease. So it kind of took off from there.
That sort of stimulated the idea. Now, you've talked about Graves' disease, which is one specific condition, but your site is interesting in that it's just a vast array of different conditions, different situations that people have. What are the types of things that you're covering now?
We have about 200 different bulletin boards right now, and it ranges anywhere from bipolar disorder to families of inmates to weight loss and obesity, depression, and again, Graves' disease.
So now it sounds like this website's really more created by the people, for the people kind of thing, as opposed to something that you've got lots of information that you post. So there's, what are sort of the key components of your website?
The main area, of course, are the bulletin boards. In association with those, we also have about 20 different online chats that go on during the week. We have links to information on the internet. We also have a program called the Share Volunteer Program, where if you have a particular illness and you just want to make yourself available for one-to-one email conversations with maybe someone with who is newly diagnosed, they can do that as well.
So now, how does the medical community feel about a website like yours? I mean, do they feel threatened by it? Are they concerned that people are going to be doing self-diagnoses? Or, you know, what's kind of the feeling about that?
We haven't had any negative feedback from the community. The information that we get is kind of secondhand, that we have physicians who kind of monitor the different bulletin boards, but they don't actively participate. What we have found, though, in terms of what we provide as a service, is the fact that it becomes a supplement to their treatment, because we always encourage them to seek out help from the physicians if they have a particular question.
Now, do you kind of monitor the boards and the chats as well? I mean, are you kind of concerned that people are going to be diagnosing each other and those types of things?
The bulletin boards kind of police themselves, but we look in from time to time to make sure that there, you know, aren't a lot of people recommending medications or particular treatments. And, you know, we'll kind of step in and say, hey, you know, this isn't what this bulletin board's all about.
Now, you have a background in nursing, so and psychiatric focus, so I think that's why some of the boards are kind of focused around psychiatric type issues.
Some of our more popular ones are.
Right. Now, bipolar, I mean, is an example. I mean, do you get concerns about folks who are, you know, pretending to be somebody different personalities, ranting, that kind of thing? Does that go on?
Like I said, bulletin boards kind of police themselves, and when the a particular individual gets in there and they kind of start stirring up trouble, the other members pretty much squash that right off the bat.
So they take care of it.
Yeah.
Now, what about anecdotes? I mean, are there some experiences that you think were interesting, people participating in those boards?
We've had a couple of people on our bulletin boards who have complained of having symptoms related to their illness to their personal physician, and their physician will say, no, it's not related to your illness. And they'll go to our bulletin boards and find messages where people with the same disorder have complained repeatedly about having that particular symptom, and they'll print out all those messages and take them to their physician.
So it kind of gives them the armor to go back in and say, no, this is a serious issue
right.
for me. That's mm-hmm. great. So what's next for the site?
We're just going to continue to add more bulletin boards and hopefully add a lot more chats in the future.
Massive amount of stuff there. It's a great site.
All right, Don, first of all, what's your background? I know you're involved in online therapy and training, but people wonder who the people are who are doing these things online. Where did you come from?
Well, I got licensed as a California psychotherapist, and then I opened an institute that trained other therapists to do psychotherapy, and then I just took my love for what I do onto the internet a little bit, too, to see how people would respond from there.
How did it work? Can you really transfer that very intimate thing that goes on during therapy from the personal relationship like we have now to doing it online where you're just on a computer?
Absolutely not.
Not?
No. There is very little connection. I believe it's really hard to do psychotherapy on the net because you don't have a personal connection.
Yeah.
And because the person on the net also has a way of either hiding or showing up either way. They make a
sure.
decision. And in therapy, I continually invite a client to show up so they can see who they are.
Yeah.
On the internet, I can't invite them to do that.
All right, so what is the value of what you're trying to do? I know part of what you're doing is training. We'll get to that later. But in terms of people actually trying to get some counseling online, how does that work then? Where do you get the value from that?
Well, you check in. You, through an exchange of email, try to recreate what you would create in a psychotherapy session. It's, again, as I say, much less than you really need to do effective psychotherapy.
Uh-huh.
So what I found is I don't believe you can do good therapy on the internet.
But can you? But is there value there? I mean, people say they go online, they talk to people, it feels good, they feel better.
I think there is, sure. To the extent that they're willing to invest themselves in expressing themselves and
mm-hmm.
exploring themselves, that's a great experience for them, whether they do that in a session, whether they do that on the internet. So the quality of what a person gets is depending on what they're
sure.
committed to getting.
Now, you do have something on your site called the Cyber Psych, right? Where you can go in there and click on anxiety and grief and things like that. What's the benefit to the person doing that?
Well, I don't have any of those specific things on this.
Uh-huh.
I have an internet journey class.
Okay.
And the specific goal of that is for people to check in and take a self-tutorial course,
uh-huh.
learning how to introspect, learning how to find their inner center,
uh-huh.
learning how to express themselves from an inside place. So I have a commitment to helping people
okay.
convert from an external gratification life to an internal
right.
gratification life, and I try to guide them through that in a self-tutorial class.
Okay, when you say you try to guide them through that, that's what I'm getting. Are they just reading the same stuff they might get if they bought some book off the shelf, or is it interactive in some way with you?
Yeah, try to get isn't the best way to say it. I invite them. What they do is they come on, they listen, they read the input just like they would in a book. Then I give them some experiments to go do, and they go out and do them.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully those experiments will bring the input to life. Then they come back to the net and they discuss it on a forum
uh-huh.
and on a live chat that we have occasionally. So that's where the interaction takes place, in the forum and on the chat
okay.
page.
Have you had feedback from any of the people who have tried this on your site? I mean, success stories or failures where they come back and say, boy, I had this problem, I did something on your site, and it's better or worse?
Not much. I've had a few. I get a lot of thank you for putting that on
uh-huh.
there. It's been really helpful, but people don't get specific about how it helps them. So you know it's helping them, but you don't know
yeah.
quite how.
Is there any particular kind of person you would recommend that could get value from going onto a site like yours and getting involved in your training?
Anybody has a commitment to their own interpersonal growth, and just go on the internet and look. There's all kinds of things out there for people to explore and other people to explore it with.
Is there a risk to doing that? Do you think people might think they're getting something they're not really getting, or think more is happening that really can happen in that limited environment as you suggested?
Yes, but I guess it wouldn't be any more than any psychotherapy session. There's always a risk to one's fooling oneself, one's thinking they're getting a lot more than
mm-hmm.
they're getting. So, again, it boils down to the person doing it
yeah.
and the commitment they have to finding out the truth about themselves. It's just another, Stewart, it's just another medium, right? It's just another medium. So you take the psychotherapy live session, that's one medium. You take the internet, it's another medium. I think there are plus and minuses for both out there for people.
Nancy, as a psychologist in the Silicon Valley, I would hazard a guess that you've come across a fair number of people who have something at least close to internet addiction. Is that the case?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it is a common problem. I don't think it's out of hand. I mean, I don't think everybody uses the internet is by far addicted. But yeah, there are a lot of people who use the internet to an excess to the point where it interferes with some major area in their life.
So what do you think it is about the internet that is this feeding place for addiction? What is it that appeals to people about it?
Well, for a lot of people, I think especially shy people, and I work with a lot of shy people that don't have a lot of social contact, there's a place to go and have some interaction with other people. And I also think it's real exciting to be online. I think people get into the excitement. It's a mood-altering type of activity. Yeah, there's a rush, definitely. It's a pleasurable activity. Especially if you're lonely and you don't have much social contact, I think it's got tremendous appeal.
Do you think it's the anonymity as well? I mean, the fact that you, if you are shy, you don't have to be you. You can be you and a whole bunch of other personalities as well. Does that play a big role?
Yeah, well, absolutely. You can have contact, but it's low risk.
Right.
I mean, you don't like the situation, you just go offline. Or you want to change your role, your sex, whatever, you could do that. I mean, yeah, it's got a whole lot of flexibility, a lot of room for use of your fantasy.
So how do you define addiction at this point? Is it, do you spend more than 2 hours a day on the internet? Or, you know, where's the cutoff point between just playing around and having a serious problem?
Well, there are a lot of ways you can identify an addiction. As I said, it has to interfere with some major area of your life. And, you know, also usually someone has complained about your addiction. That's another way we find out about it.
Because, I mean, typically with addictions, you don't think you have an addiction, isn't
no,
it? Sort of,
that's right.
You think everything's okay.
You think everything's okay. Another key sign is when you're offline and you're thinking about being on the internet. When are you going to get back in that chat room? What are we talking about now? You know, what games are being played? I mean, that's a sign of an addiction to the point where it's sort of taking over the rest,
it's kind of consuming you,
exactly.
So now, what would be some examples of some people who have had addictions? I mean, what kind of things would they do that seems really out of sorts?
Well, for example, there's people that stay up all night going to work the next day and can't get their work done. That's a real common one. I've run into that a number of times. There's also the kind of classic, what I call classic example, of the woman who doesn't know that her husband's basically has a sex addiction online. You know, so she's wondering where her husband went. She doesn't see much of him. He disappears in the study after work at night.
Right.
She walks into the study and finds he's in an online sexual relationship with someone. I mean, that's a pretty big shock for a relationship, and a number of the cases that I've worked with, women are pretty much ready to leave after they're happening.
Is that adultery at that point, or is it, what do you do?
Well, we just basically refer to it as an emotional affair, which basically you're involved with someone outside of the relationship.
So, I mean, well, what do you do? Do you do being a couple in together? Do you talk through it? I mean, are you dealing with the internet addiction, or is this something else that's manifesting itself through the internet?
Well, addiction in its own right, I mean, it has its own, brings about its own problems, but usually there's some other problems underneath that. For example, in this case, yes, there's obviously some problems in that relationship that need to be addressed, absolutely. Or if it's someone who's really shy and on the internet, obviously you need to teach that person some social skills, help them be able to go out in the world and make regular relationships happen.
So how do you give therapy to people who have internet addictions? What do you do?
Well, people don't typically come in and say, you know, hi, Dr. Wesson, I have an internet addiction. That just doesn't happen. I mean, I've run into that, I think, once over the last few years, but it's not typical. People come in with other kinds of problems. They're too shy. They're not happy in their relationships. They're a couple. I've seen a number of couples that came in, and the woman's complaining about the man's online use. You know, we're complaining about, who are these people that are emailing my husband? I've heard that one a number of times. I've even had women who were upset because they went into their husband's email. God forbid anybody would do that, right? I know that violates, you know, the ethics, definitely. It's an email from all these women. Now, who are those people?
Right.
Well, that's going to have an effect on a relationship for sure, and those problems need to be dealt with in the relationship, so you want to bring the couple in for that.
But I'm hearing that the internet addiction itself is not the problem. It's really, there's other issues going on, and the internet becomes the platform for it to come.
Well, it's really both in a way. First, you have to deal with, this is what is important about getting help, is you have to deal with an addiction as an addiction, meaning you have to help the person learn to stop their use.
Right.
I mean, they don't stop the internet use, but they have to be able to cut back on it.
Right.
To regulate it. And then you have to deal with the problems underneath. So you're talking about finding yourself the kind of psychotherapy where really both issues are addressed.
We're here. here with Larry Magid, syndicated columnist for the LA Times and contributing editor of Home PC Magazine. Larry, there's so much talk in the news these days about the browser wars and Internet Explorer and Microsoft and Netscape and Navigator. I want to ask you from a user's point of view, does it really matter what browser I use?
To me, it's like Coke and Pepsi. I can't tell the difference. Some people can. Really, they both fundamentally do the same thing, and they both do them very well. I don't think there's a great deal of difference from the user perspective between Explorer and Netscape.
So, I mean, this is a business antitrust story, not a computer
user
story?
Oh, long term, there's some very important implications about Microsoft coming to dominate the software industry. Mm-hmm. But in terms of the user experience, you're going to get a good experience either way.
What happens occasionally, you see a site and it says, this site optimized to be seen on Navigator 3.0.
Yeah.
Now, if I'm on Explorer, what am I going to miss?
Well, unless the site operator is either crazy or tied in with one of these companies, they're going to make it look good with either site, either browser.
Mm-hmm.
But in theory, it's possible that there might be graphics or animation or certain kinds of just fonts that wouldn't show.
Well.
But most of the sites are optimized for both these days.
A lot of people use AOL or CompuServe to get on there. They don't even know what browser
they're
using.
That's right. I mean, it turns out AOL is using Explorer, but how would they know
right. Unless
they're experts?
Does it make sense to have both browsers on your computer just to be safe?
I do, because occasionally there'll be a Java application that might not run on Explorer and will run on Netscape, and once in a while, I'll have something I want to do and I have to switch browsers. Not very often. But
can there be conflicts on your computer then? You don't know what browser to go to?
No, most of the time. The only problem.
No software problems?
I haven't any problems. I use them interchangeably. And
okay. As
long as you're careful about what's default, what isn't, you're
whatever
okay.
Browser you have, probably good enough.
Or both.
Thank you, Larry.
My pleasure.
Olga, I think no conversation about therapy on the web would be complete without a place that people could go and sort of create their own fictional characters online. You've created such a place, the company therapist. Tell me about the world of Dr. Charles Bayless.
Well, Dr. Charles Bayless was called by this dysfunctional computer company called Silicon Impression, Inc.
Ah,
and
I think I've heard of that. No, it's not real, is it?
No. There's some reality there.
Right.
And he provides mental support to the people who work for the company.
Okay, and now people can go online and can create their own characters in this company.
Absolutely, people can go and just read what's been created, or they feel inspired and they can go and create their own characters, and usually it works out that they work for SII and go see a doctor.
Mm-hmm. Now I was reading some of the things. It's pretty fun just to go on there and actually read and just, you get engrossed. It's a little bit like a soap 10, opera.
10,000 pages worth of stuff.
10,000, really?
Oh,
okay, well, it's engrossing. It's
if you like big books.
It's a little risque. I think there's some interesting stuff. People really put a labor of love into creating these characters. How much time do people spend, and are they obsessed with it?
We spend an enormous amount of time, but our authors probably spend 3 to 5 hours writing the sessions and editing them a week.
A week?
A
wow.
Week.
So this is
so, yeah,
involved.
Oh, absolutely. And then they read what's on the web, and they can't wait to see it come up, and you know, there's a lot of emotional involvement.
Right.
It feels like you're creating a real person in a real world.
In this world.
Yeah.
And now these characters interact with each other. Tell me about some of the things that go on and how do people react to it?
There's lots of interactions possible.
Mm-hmm.
You could be a solitary character and just live in your little world, or you can communicate with other authors, and we have authors who had affairs with each other,
really?
Or actually their characters had affairs with each other.
Ah.
And, you know, there's all those subtexts, and there's,
okay.
you know.
So your typical office place.
Absolutely.
All kinds of things going on. And it's a chance for people to get to see not just the surface of what goes on at work, but the real undercurrents that
underlie. Oh, yes.
That
all
underlie.
The dysfunctional problems that would happen in the workplace.
Ah, so this is a good way to blow off some steam probably from your regular job as well.
Well, we conceived that a computer company sort of requiring 80 hours of your time a week, and all your social life happens in the workplace.
Right.
You date the people that are there, and your ex-wife or ex-husband might work next to you.
Right.
It creates a bit of a tension.
And you would feel it there.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Now, is this site created as a therapy site, as a way to people to go write about their problems, or is this created as an educational, a learning tool, a way for people to get better at their writing, or a little bit of both?
I think it depends on the goal of the author.
Mm-hmm.
We have one author who wanted to bring the world to the attention of the problems of people with chronic fatigue syndrome.
Really?
And that's what her character, that was her problem,
and
how she
ongoing.
Got fired, and what was the problems were, and that was one thing.
Okay.
And then there's amateur writers who were closet writers for years, and then they found the company therapist and actually writing and creating work.
And
that's getting
and
published.
Oh, yeah. Really?
Well, you know, it's getting published on the web, and you know, it's
and
getting
has it
recognition.
Led to other things, or I mean,
people get job based on the work that they've done, and that's terrific. That's sort of the biggest praise that we get is
right.
that other people get jobs as authors.
right.
based on their work.
Right.
That,
right. You know something must be going well then.
Yeah.
Now, is really this nice. Something that you've approached other learning institutions or things to try to get them to sort of create part of this collaborative drama?
Well, we are hoping that this could somehow become part of a creating writing class for university.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be nice. It hasn't happened yet.
Right.
But we work with San Francisco State Multimedia Program, and we had interns who worked on the site, and that worked out really well.
Okay. So now you guys do this. I mean, to create this site must take a lot of work.
Oh, God.
And do you see yourself continuing at this, or where do you see the company therapist going?
Well, we're going to continue this for a while. We're mm-hmm. obviously very much attached to the
right.
site and to the characters, you know, probably as much as the authors are, and we look forward to every session and anticipate it.
Right.
And but you know, we're hoping, you know, this is not a moneymaker for us in mm-hmm. any way, but mm-hmm. we're hoping that maybe someday something great will happen, like a movie.
A movie? The book. The company
book,
therapist.
The movie, right.
Right.
See it on a big screen,
right.
Dr. Bellis. Who is Dr. Bellis?
Right. Okay, well, we're gonna hopefully check out the movie in a while, but now we'll check it out online.
Great.
So, Stewart, with online therapy, lots of different websites out there, the one topic I thought would have a vast amount of information would be AIDS.
Surprisingly not so, Jane. We went looking. This is obviously a case where people need therapy and counseling if you're dealing with AIDS or HIV. Not that many sites out there, but a couple of very, very good ones.
So what were the ones you found?
Two I found I liked. One is brand new. It was put up by the Sonoma County AIDS Organization. It's called sonoma-aids.org. A couple of things I really liked about it. A terrific chat section. You know, online therapy and counseling not only comes from people with expertise and counselors, but from people who share your problem.
Right.
You want to talk to other people with AIDS, other people taking these drugs, other people who have HIV. It's a terrifically organized chat section. Very easy to follow the thread. You can see what's going on. I liked it a lot. A very good part of it. Another thing I really liked on that particular site, grieving is, unfortunately, people die of AIDS.
Yeah.
And grieving is part of the process, and you need counseling and therapy for that. One of the really nice things on that site, you can put up a memorial for someone you know who died of AIDS.
Sort of like the AIDS quilt.
Kind of a virtual quilt in a way, and actually has a little engine. You can go in there and put up a picture and put up some words. And I think it's part of the process that people have to go through in grieving for a lost person and share that with someone. The web really provides a great opportunity, and that site does that.
Now, one of the things about AIDS is that there's a lot of disinformation out there about, you know, what causes AIDS
yeah.
and all those types. Is there a site out there where people can get better information?
Yeah, the other good one I like is called thebody.com. This is a massive site, tons of information on there. One of the things I really liked about that site is they cover AIDS conferences. I mean, it's obviously a hot research topic. Somewhere in the world, there's an AIDS conference going on every single week.
Right.
And how do you get access to that information? It's not so easy. This site actually goes out and covers it and posts transcripts from major papers that are presented and sessions that are presented at these conferences. You can just go on there and read the stuff so you really can get real information, not the disinformation. So that's a real
and live, real time.
Yeah,
as well.
Yeah, it's
yeah.
a current sub, a real strong part of that site, I think, in particular. The other thing I like about thebody.com is a section called Quality of Life. And this is just practical, day-to-day, down-to-earth stuff. If I'm on these particular drugs, what food should I be eating? How do I deal with benefits? How do I deal with going to work when I'm sick? How do I deal with friends
and family? Sort of the practical issues.
Just really day-to-day stuff, and there's just tons of information, very well presented. So I think for somebody who's suffering from AIDS or has HIV, or if you're involved in family or friends that are dealing with the AIDS problem, it's a really valuable site. And it's sort of non-threatening. You know,
yeah,
it's the anonymity again. So I think if we're talking therapy and counseling, AIDS is an area where I think the web really provides a great service.
Definitely. You can check those sites out.
So we saw some examples of therapy online and counseling on the web and so on. Anybody change their mind? You see some value in the guys you talked to?
I'm still a little skeptical about group therapy and therapists online. I think it's a lot of
but
risk
the company
involved.
Therapist?
But the company therapist, it's almost like art therapy in a way. You know, it's allowing people to kind of unlock their psyche through creating a persona,
uh-huh.
writing about it online. Yeah, I think it works, and it seems like there's a lot of people.
People feel good about
they
it?
They feel good. Looks like people are improving their writing, for one thing, and that's a great thing. And two, I think they really are exploring their inner selves through these
yeah.
characters.
And how about the ones you looked at?
Well, I think there's great merits in being able to share your experiences. I think the only concern I have is that you can get addicted to the whole process of sharing
itself.
Your experience.
Well,
yeah, you can
people
get kind
do
of
the
off.
Therapy, right? People
right.
in therapy 15
yep.
years, right? They just keep
so you get
the
kind
thing.
Of obsessive about chats and those types of things.
I think it's useful just because it's cathartic. People like to talk about their problems, and it almost doesn't matter who's at the other end in a way.
Right.
You get a chance to have a dialogue and get stuff off your chest, and maybe you feel better about it, so maybe some of the stuff is useful. Anyhow, that's group therapy on the web. We'll see you here next week at the Internet Cafe.
Net Cafe is brought to you by the Oracle Small Business Suite.
one completely integrated application that helps make it easier to run your business, including accounting, sales and service, your web presence, and more. Additional funding is provided by PC2PC, the online migration service from PC First, moving files, applications, and preferences from your old computer to your new one.